There's a great relationship between that gospel and the second reading of Paul. As you heard Deacon John proclaim the gospel, it said there, he rebuked or spoke against the evil spirit and told it, be quiet. He quieted the evil spirit. And then a line in the second reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, it says, I want you to be free of anxiety. He quieted the evil spirit, and Paul says, I want you to be free from anxiety. I'm sure many of you look at the cartoons on Sunday, and one of them is Garfield, of course. He's a great, commentator on human life. He's a cat, as you know. And so in this one particular episode, there is Garfield sitting there in all his large splendor. And he is smoking a cigar, looking outside. It's a terrible winter storm that's brewing outside. But he's enjoying the warm comfort of the home. But as he looks out the window, there's one of his other feline friends who is freezing, turning blue, and being covered with snow. And he shakes his head and he said, I just can't take it anymore. I can't take this suffering. I just have to do something. So he gets off the couch and he goes to the window and he quickly closes the blinds very tight. He doesn't want to look at it. I don't want to look at that. I don't want to see it. And I think in many ways that's what you and I do when we're faced with things that we feel are beyond us, or will overwhelm us, or what we can't deal with. The evil spirits need to be silenced, and the anxiety, as Paul would say, we need to be released of. So you and I, what do we do? In that silly example of Garfield, what it's really saying is, be careful you're not following that example. That's not gospel at all. To pull the covers over your head, to close the blinds of your mind so you don't have to look at something, or to think that this out there is going to overwhelm me. And that's the real harm, isn't it? I begin to think I'm all on my own. I can't overcome this. I can't battle this. I can't in any way fight it. And that's where the gospel is so good. Mark gives us a couple ways of combating that sense of fear. The fear and anxiety that can come at us. And we begin to get overwhelmed. We almost get paralyzed by it. So one of the first things that you caught in that gospel reading, what Mark says is, the Lord quiets the voices of the evil ones. And there's a voice in all of our heads sometimes. It tells us that you're all alone. You're never going to have enough strength or power to overcome this situation, to deal with this event in your life, to have some way of lifting your heart from the sorrow, from mending the brokenness, from moving beyond the addiction. Whatever it is that's causing you that fear and anxiety, the Lord would say, I have already quieted those evil spirits. I can quiet that in you. But you'll have to let me. You'll have to allow me to quiet that voice. Whatever the voice is saying that you know is not true to the gospel. I am not alone, the Lord would remind me. You are not facing this on yourself. I am always with you. I walk with you. I endure these things with you. But you see, I get overwhelmed and think it's all about me and I can't do it. So the first lesson is, yes, God is with you. You do not have to face this situation alone. But the second, equally important, the Lord is telling the spirit to be silent because the spirit, the evil one, is the only one who is really knowing the truth. This is the Messiah. This is the Lord. This is the Redeemer. So in that phrase, the Lord is affirming the truth. And so he would say to us, now that I've silenced the wrong voice, affirm the right voice in your head. Remember, I have the power. I can help you face it. I can help you endure it. I can help you find your way through it. I can help you reestablish your life. I can help you rebuild what is torn down. I can help mend what is really wounded, and I can put back together the pieces. That's the truth. And that's what he's trying to say in the midst of that synagogue for the evil spirit. Remember the truth and hold on to it. I've silenced the lie. Don't keep repeating it. That's a good part of this gospel that we can live by. For all of us who are racked with fear or somehow torn by our anxieties, it's a deep hole. And if you've ever been a part of that anxiety or fear, it's a spiral. It pulls you down, and it never releases you, not unless you stop listening to that voice, let it be silent, and listen to the true voice, the one of God that says, I'm with you, I'm here. But then he reminds us something else, that nothing is beyond God's power. And what we have to do is we have to name what it is that I want to be healed, where it is I need to be somehow changed, converted. But you know what I often do? What I do is I often name what the problem is and not what I need the healing of. For example, if I'm dealing with a severe illness, I just say, Lord, get rid of this illness, and then I'll be lifted. My spirit will be okay. Then I'll be able to live better. Not really, because as soon as this illness, this difficulty passes, the underlying problem is not healed. I don't trust God to get me through it. I don't believe God is strong enough to help me endure it. I think I'm going to be crushed by whatever happens to me. What I need to be healed of is a sense of real trust, a real deep faith. That's what I need the healing for. That's what I need to say, Lord, heal this in me, my lack of trust in you, my doubting that you can be there, my wondering if you really want to comfort me and heal me. That's what I need to be naming. Not just the illness, the disease, the brokenness, or whatever, something more underneath it. Because that's what will let me live better without the anxiety of Paul and without the voices of the evil spirits of Mark's gospel. That's all those three things that Mark tells me. He reminds me very strongly about all three of them. But then you have Paul who tells us something else. As he wants to get rid of our fear and anxiety, he does a little differently. He says, what causes many of us to be fearful, anxious, is we are at odds with ourselves. We say one thing, but we live another. We are not consistent in the way we act. We have a double life, some of us. We act one way when we're out in public and church and doing things, but I am another person in the way I live my life. And Paul is saying, no wonder there's great anxiety or fear. You have to have a unity of heart and mind, of purpose and meaning, of mission. Because whenever there's disunion, whenever they're working at cross purposes, you're going to feel anxious. You're going to feel restless. You're not going to feel like you know where you're going, because in fact, I'm going in two different directions. That's what Paul is pleading for. He said, let there be a unity of heart and mind and soul in you. Get rid of all that duplicity, that double life standard that says, I have one judgment for you and another judgment for me. I'm harsh with you and lenient with myself. Or I excuse my behaviors. I allow for inappropriate behaviors. I say it's okay because it's not that bad. I make all kinds of excuses why I can live two lives. Paul says that's what is the root of your own anxiety. So it seemed to me that the readings were particularly helpful for us in the modern society. Mark and Paul are saying, let me reduce your stress, your anxiety, your fear. And Mark says, I'll do it by silencing the evil voices, the ones that tell you things that are not true, the ones that continue the lie. And not only will I silence the lie, but I will remind you that I have the power, that you're not alone, and I can do these things. And then I tell you, just name what you want to be healed. Not the illness, the situation, the event, but what inside your soul really needs that healing touch of God. A deepening faith, an abiding trust, whatever it is. And then look to Paul as well, who says, I will calm your anxiety and ease your fears, but it has to be a unity within you of heart and mind, not leading one life this time and another one that way. There has to be a consistency of the values I profess and the behaviors I lead. I thought they were good readings because they remind me that my fear really is useless. And it reminds me, don't act like Garfield. Don't pull the blinds over. Don't cover your head and run away from it or close up within it. You and I can face it because the Lord has silenced the voices, strengthened our hearts, renewed our trust, and reminded us that all we need to do is live with one purpose in mind, His mission, His mission.